So hey guys, I realize I'm a bit late on this whole thing. I recently saw Prometheus, like a couple of days ago, so I kind of wanted to talk about it. I almost did because it's been out for a while, everybody who wants to see it probably has seen it, and I didn't think it was really worth it, but the more I thought about it, the more I started thinking, you know, maybe I should do a video on it, you know, maybe, I don't know. So, Prometheus, the prequel, but not really a prequel to Alien. I actually liked it. I did. I know it's gotten a lot of bad press. Some people will love it. Some people hate it. You got some who are in the middle. I think I'm roughly in the middle, but I'm a little more towards the liking it side. It wasn't a bad movie, but it definitely had things that had me going, that's dumb. So, the spoiler-free portion, if you're going into it looking for an Alien prequel, you're going to be let down, in my personal opinion. If you're going in for just a sci-fi movie, that's perfectly fine. I thought for a sci-fi movie it was really good. The visuals were really good. The story wasn't that bad. The main thing I liked were the visuals. I did see it in IMAX 3D, and, you know, once we got on the planet, I really couldn't tell what was 3D. Like, the only things that were really stood out as 3D were the shots in space through the cockpit of the ship, and like the holographic projections, holographic maps, they have these little spherical orbs that can scan things. They have like a giant scanning like emitter. Those were best 3D, but besides that, I really couldn't tell it was in 3D. So maybe when I skip to 3D, I don't know. But that's all I can really say. I did like it. That's the non-spoilery version. Now, on to potential spoilers. The main thing I didn't like about Prometheus, the general plot is that there's an archaeologist, I believe she is. Her last name is Shaw. I forgot her first name entirely. And her, I guess, boyfriend, basically, are trying to track down our makers, who made us. And they're doing this there's like five or six symbols across the world, different cultures that are completely unrelated, different time periods, whatever. They're finding this exact symbol, and they figure out that it's a constellation. So that's what leads them to this. But what kind of, it seemed like quite a jump, because they find this one map, and in a cave, it's the oldest one there is. I think it's like 35,000 years old, if I remember correctly. It's the oldest one they found so far, and she immediately goes, they want us to find them. How do you know that exactly? That kind of bugged me. Like, it's a matter of finding it, then figure out how old it is, and then they suddenly go, they want us to find them. Maybe? I don't know. But then it jumps to them going through space. There's actually like three openings for the movie. There's an opening that's like many, 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 many years ago. It's the birth of civilization, which I really didn't like. This gave away a big, like, surprise kind of thing for me. You know, you see one of the engineers, which that's what I hated. Like, I've been wanting to see more of the engineers, the space jockeys, for so many years. I had this build-up for it, and then I got spoiled by seeing what it looks like with the NECA figure, and I was like, no, NECA! I didn't want to be spoiled like that, but then you see it in the movie, you don't know it's a space jockey yet, you don't know it's an engineer, you just see this really humanoid buff guy that looked really, really fake. The face was off, the muscles, I don't know if it was a real muscular guy, if it was a bodysuit, I have no idea. It didn't look right to me, but he drinks this black goo, dissolves in agony, and then his DNA reforms, and that's where the DNA for humans come from. So that's how we came to be. And that gave away a lot of the movie right there, just that little opening bit. And then it goes to Shaw and her boyfriend finding the symbols, and it cuts like 2 or 3 years later, and then that's when the movie like begins. So that opening was kind of I didn't really like that, but once we're out there, you know, the cast wasn't that bad. Shaw was played by, I think it's Rooney Mara. I don't know her name exactly. The girl who was the original, from The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, the trilogy, the Swedish version, not the American one. She wasn't bad. She seemed just kind of there. She didn't really bring much much that I really liked or didn't like. It's just, she was kind of there. I forgot her boyfriend's name entirely. Michael Fassbender is David the robot, which I thought he did a great job with it. Charlize Theron is Vickers. She's kind of in charge to an extent. Like, there's a captain of the ship who runs the ship, and then Shaw's like the leader of the team, and then Vickers, I think she's like the main head honcho at Wayland, the Wayland Corporation, and she's there, and Idris Elba, I think his name is, he was Heimdall in Thor. He's the captain of the ship. I really liked his character. I thought he was probably one of the better ones. I really liked him. I don't know why. I want to see more stuff with him in it. I know he has a show that I need to check out, but I liked him. And just the rest of the cast, you know, I think there's like 17 crew members on the ship. We meet Shaw, her boyfriend, Vickers. I'm going to count David, because they counted Ash in the original ones, and Ash was a robot. Did I count the captain? I mean, I'd count the captain. Vickers, Shaw, boyfriend, David, captain. There's a geologist, a doctor woman, another guy that I forgot who, what his role was. The captain has two kind of co-pilot buddies, so we get to know roughly 10 people of the 17-person crew, unless I'm missing somebody. They didn't really bring a whole lot. The geologist annoyed me the most. That's one thing that really buzzed me with these movies. You've got these people who are, I'm assuming, the top of their field. If they're being whisked away by a corporation to investigate a planet, they're in space, all kind of stuff, you would assume they're professionals, they're the best. Well, the geologist guy, the quickest chance he gets, he puts pot in the respirator of his suit, and he's walking around this cave just getting high. That really bugged me. It's the same problem that I had with the Avengers with the Galaga scene. It's just, you have these guys that are making professional, yet they're on this planet. You got to bring the pot along. You're trapped in this cave for a night. You don't know what's in the cave. Sounds like a good idea to get high. That really bugged me. I really didn't like that. And then the other scientist guy with him who was trapped in this cave, the first thing that just kind of makes me go, why? Ah! There's this snake thing that pops up. That looks dangerous. You know, it's got a weird little face. What's the first thing he does? Oh, it's beautiful. Aren't you pretty? And he gets close. The thing opens up like a cobra, starts hissing at him. And he's, oh, it's so beautiful. Aren't you so adorable? Of course, the thing grabs his arm and kills him. It's like, no! Don't touch it! And that's kind of like, that's kind of a reoccurring element of the movie. You have a lot of people saying, don't touch it, and then people touch it. For David, I can kind of look past that, because David has his own agenda from the start of the mission. And we learn it later on. I can see David ignoring all the stuff, because he has his own goal, his own mission, so it, screw what they say, I'm doing what I want. I can understand David. The other ones, common sense, you know, just don't touch it. Don't touch the black goo that's oozing out of these jars. You know, don't do this stuff. That bugged me. And the pilot, of course, had his own little thing. The first chance he has to getting laid, he leaves his post and goes off to do this thing. Doesn't have anybody come in to sit in for him, to watch the monitors, where these two guys are trapped in a cave off on their own. That really bugged me. I thought he was a really good pilot. He seemed to take his duties seriously. He seemed good at his job. But the first chance he gets to get some action, he leaves his post, doesn't put anybody else in charge. Like, you've got all these people on board. You have your two co-pilots. Have one of them watching the monitors while these two guys are trapped in the cave. He doesn't do that, and I didn't like that. Everybody else was just okay. No one really stood out to me. The archaeologist's boyfriend was just the archaeologist's boyfriend. The archaeologist was the archaeologist. Just that kind of stuff. I haven't looked too much into, like, philosophical discussions of the movie, what other people thought. I'm just going off my first impression of the movie. A big thing that I really didn't like were actually the alien tie-in kind of things. It honestly feels like Prometheus was an already planned movie, and then they said, hey, let's make it an Alien prequel. it kind of felt like that. You had the story where it's the archaeologist and her boyfriend tried to find their maker, their creators. They have this team where they've tracked where they've deciphered where this constellation is. They've got to find it. Things go wrong. The robot tries to kill people in a way, kind of. And there's an underlying plot. And then, you know, that could be an okay story. But with alien stuff, you know, throwing in the Wayland Corporation was okay. That wasn't a big deal. But Charles Whalen, I think his name was Charles Whalen in this, just didn't belong. And having Guy Pearce play him made no sense at all. He had one of the worst old man prosthetics that I've seen in a long time. Like, it was very, very much, I guess, cheap special effects kind of stuff. He didn't look like an old person. He looked like a guy wearing an old man suit. Now, why not, if you're going for the alien connection, why not get Lance Henriksen in to play Wayland? You know, it's been long enough since we've seen him in the previous movies. He's aged a fair bit. You would have to put on a lot of prosthetics. He's getting up there in years. Put a little bit here and there, and he could have been a Charles Whalen. You've had him appear as Whalen before, at least different iterations of Whalen. Why not do it again? Guy Pearce being there just made no sense to me. I didn't like it. I know there's that one viral clip online where we see, like, young Whalen giving his address kind of thing, and that's Guy Pearce playing him, but in the movie we see him as an old man. Why not cast an older actor? That really bugged me a lot. Whenever he's there, that took me away from the movie. I was focusing on this guy's just horrible stuff. But him being there just made no sense. They tried to reenact the alien egg scene, where you see this field of eggs with all these jars sitting there. The jars didn't make much sense to me, because they're so close together, humans had a hard time walking through them. And he just, the engineers of space jockeys are big. They're big, hulking people. I don't know why they would just leave them in this area unless they never go in there, unless it's some kind of cold storage unit. I could kind of see it being some kind of cold storage, because as soon as they open the doors of this place, it starts getting warmer, and then the jars start leaking out the goo. I could kind of see that. If I go to that angle, it's okay. And the space jockeys, I had it in my mind that the space jockeys would be a somewhat peaceful people for some bizarre reason. I've wanted to learn more about the space jockeys. You know, we saw that one in Alien. Ever since then, I know a lot of people have been wondering, who are the space jockeys? And I don't know what kind of expanded fiction there is out there in terms of books, anything like that. I don't know. I'm just going off the movies. And I didn't care for it. I really didn't. I don't know. It just, it bugs me having them being, you know, the creators of man and that kind of stuff. From my understanding, the space jockeys made us and then wanted to wipe us out. And they were stopped in the middle of doing this. So for 2,000 years, there's been a single space jockey that's frozen in suspended animation. As soon as he wakes up, he sees us, tries to kill us, tries to take his ship off to destroy the Earth. I think it's proposed that the reason for that is because the death of Jesus, I think. Because I'm trying to think, like, you know, what would happen 2,000 years ago that would prompt the space jockeys to want to attack our species? Jesus? So I don't know if they're trying to say that the death of Jesus was so big, his sacrifice kind of thing, was enough that they said that we should die. Or are they implying Jesus was an alien? I honestly have no idea what was going on there. I should probably look into that, because I'm curious, but at the same time, I'm like, that's dumb. Why would Jesus be an alien? That's stupid. But that kind of stuff is just, why not make a different species? Why does that be the space jockeys? Why? As far as the xenomorphs go, when we get in the ship, there's a mural that has a xenomorph. It's not exactly the one from Alien, but it has the similar head shape. It's got, like, the skinny body. The arms are really skinny. It is a xenomorph mural. And then at the end, we do see a xenomorph. It's, again, it's not the same one as Alien and those other movies, but it's in the same kind of vein. It has a very similar look. It's black, has the elongated head. Its mouth even starts to jut out like it's turning into one. And it was created by a somewhat facehugger, a really giant facehugger. It's like, there's a lot of things, it's like, it feels like if they had taken out the xenomorphs, taken out the facehuggers, which didn't really do much. Like, it's only there for, like, one scene, and that's to introduce the xenomorph at the end. The space jockeys being there, just a lot of it didn't work with me, and I kind of wonder what the movie would have been like if they had kept the alien stuff out. I am curious if this was an actual proposed film, and they just said, let's tweak it and make an alien prequel, not a prequel kind of thing. That's honestly what it feels like. It feels like, that's the best description that I can think of, that we saw for months, even a year. It's a prequel to Alien, but it's not really a prequel. That is dead on. I see it really much as, like, in Predator 2, where there was that one shot of the xenomorph skull. It's not a sequel, it's not anything like that, it's just telling you it's in the same universe. That's what Prometheus felt like. It doesn't take place on the ship that we saw in the first Alien movie. Not the same space jockey at the cannon. It's not the same planet. It's not that kind of stuff. And so at some point, we're going to go to a different planet, see a different ship, and then that'll be the prequel to Alien, which it just doesn't work for me. One of my bigger complaints overall is the ending. This is obviously a spoiler. I shouldn't have to say anything. The big spoiler of the ending is that the only person left alive is Shaw and David. David being only his head. So the movie ends with Shaw and David taking off in this other engineer ship that they've seen to go to the homeworld to meet their creator. And that's how the movie ends. It's this big, big kind of, oh, they're gonna go meet him thing. It's the exact same ending as Mission to Mars. The movie with, like, I think it's Gary Sinise and Jerry O'Connell. I want to say even Tim Robbins is in it. That movie ends with them, like, they're going to Mars. They learn that our creators came from Mars. One ship departed Mars as it was dying. Landed in Earth. The DNA from that created humanity. Created all that stuff. And the movie ends with Gary Sinise, I'm pretty sure, unless I'm mistaken, taking off in this last ship on Mars left by the creators to go find their people. That's how the movie ends. It's the exact same ending as Prometheus. Why? I would like something different. I would like a different ending. I know it's hard to have movies that are different plots. We've had so many stories over the years, but make something different, something unique. I would have liked that a lot better. There are a lot of things that, a lot of other things that kind of stood out. I think one review that I read, maybe there were two reviews, I honestly don't remember, but mentioned that the, Vickers, Charlize Theron, has her own, like, escape pod kind of layout. It's basically like an apartment, and it has a medical bay that's only been configured to work on human anatomy. It can't do, like, a C-section kind of thing. That didn't bug me, because the big plot twist is that Charles Whalen isn't really dead, that he's really been in sleep this whole time, and that it's configured to work for him, since he's the most important person on this mission. It's to work on him. That didn't bug me. What bugged me is that Shaw, when she's trying to have a C-section, she gets pregnant, quickly pregnant, she reconfigures it quickly to do, like, an abdominal surgery, climbs inside, laser cuts her open, I don't think even with any kind of anesthesia, I don't think, she was in a lot of pain, but, so, imagine this, she's in this tube, cuts her stomach open with a laser, clamps inside, pulls out the squid baby. There's a squid baby. And then her stomach is then sealed and stapled back together. She climbs out and is able to run almost instantly. I didn't like that. I didn't agree. Like, maybe she had a really big boost of adrenaline, but I would imagine having your stomach laser cut open and then stapled shut, I would imagine you're not going to feel like running. Like, that really didn't work. And when she's having, like, contractions, like, run, 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 get up, run, 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 I don't think contractions work that way. Now, granted, I've never been pregnant. I don't ever plan to be. So, I don't know what it's like, but my general idea, it hurts a lot more than just, kind of thing. I didn't like that she was suddenly up and able to run around that much. Later on, she is kind of like, ow. But I didn't like that. It's just she's suddenly able to run around and escape this thing. I think those were my major complaints with the movie. I'm trying to think back everything. The alien stuff didn't work for me. Charles Whalen's makeup didn't work. Everything else was fine. You know, David doing what he did was for Charles and for his father. His whole mission was perfectly fine. What he did was understandable. But, I am curious to see what the movie would have been like without the alien influences. Now, with that said, I did enjoy it. It was a good movie. I may buy it when it comes out on DVD and Blu-ray. I probably will. I did like it. The visuals were really nice. The special effects, everything was really well done. The ship design, I'm a sucker for spaceships. I am. The ships were great. Just the overall atmosphere was great, you know. But it's just the little alien bits just really didn't work for me. And we did have like a space zombie that came out of nowhere. Like I think there's this whole implication that the black goo. I don't know. I'm trying to think. Because the alien on Earth takes it. It kills him, but then it uses it. Takes DNA and it creates humanity. And then you have the one pot smoker. The goo gets put on him. And he turns into a space zombie. And then archaeologist guy drinks the black goo. And he turns into a creature. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense, because he was a pretty good guy. He actually sacrificed himself so no one else would get affected. So, I think if the black goo goes with whatever kind of person you are, it wouldn't have turned him into a creature. It would have done more with him. I don't know. There's a lot of stuff that's not explained. There's a lot that needs to be explained in the sequel. If they do a sequel, maybe they'll explain it better. But the overall consensus is that the aliens don't like us anymore. They have the black goo to wipe out humanity. And they were stopped 2,000 years ago. They're trying to do it again. For all we know, when Shaw lands on their planet, they'll see her and go,
human.
And then try to kill us all over again. We don't know what's going to happen. If they do make a sequel, I will see it. If they, I liked it enough. When I was walking out, I saw they had little mini posters for it. I took a few, because they had a huge stack, and I got like six. They're this really, really nice kind of thicker stock that, like, it's not just a single poster kind of thing. I did like it. I did. That's all I can really, really say for it. If you have any desire to see it, I would say see it in theaters. IMAX and 3D, it's up to you. The IMAX probably what helped a lot more in terms of, like, the overall landscapes that we saw. Great. So once we're on the planet, it's more like desert. There's not a whole lot of actual landscape, like not like greenery. 3D, it's up to you. I like I said, I couldn't tell much with it. I actually got a headache with it. It's the first time I've ever gotten a headache with a 3D movie, which kind of surprised me. But I would say check it out. It's not a bad movie. Excuse me. And you may enjoy it. I know opinions are. There's quite a bit. Some people love it. Some people hate it. Some people said it was okay. For me, yeah, it's okay with leaning, again, more towards good. So, you may like it, you may not. I don't know. If you have any kind of desire to see it, you should. You should give it a chance. Give it a shot. And then if you don't like it, well, you're not alone. That's a great review. That's great. Yeah, no. So, I hope you guys have a great day, and I will see you around. Thanks for watching, as always, and take care.